Well, first you have to make people part of that strategy, part of those values, of those principles, of those rules. I mean, if they don't have a part of that, it's difficult that they adopt it.
Carolina Doldán, partner at Change Agency in Buenos Aires, voted one of the top female leaders in all of South America. She's an expert at communicating change inside a company. George Bernard Shaw said, "The single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has taken place." In a moment, the unmatched Carolina Doldán. Even great leaders get stuck. Others thrive. I'm Mark Cook, New York Times bestselling author and president of Windfall Partners. We get leaders unstuck and thriving with their teams. Clients upgrade leaders' retreats and conferences with my five-star keynotes and breakouts on leaders' bold encounters. Also, leaders get weekly consulting as they execute key steps. Plus, brief check-ins guarantee results live or via Zoom. After turnarounds as chief executive and 9 global studies of 2 million award-winning leaders, I've coached 4,000 client wins at top brands with my approach in over 50 cities worldwide. My Bold Encounters is an advanced system for leading. First, powerful steps on a path forward. Second, problem-solving skills that beat obstacles fast. Leaders create revenue breakthroughs and clients see new profits. Now let's lead with Bold Encounters today. Today we have with us Carolina Doldán of Change Agency. She's working out of a suburb of Buenos Aires. Someone who's a specialist at getting to know people and communicating within companies with people that you don't usually communicate effectively or at all with. She has won the Acon Award, which is supported by Image Magazine. They did some work for one of their clients, Pepsi, and many other US companies, and they won the category of internal communication. How are you, Carolina?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
I wanted to just ask you about how your career began.
When I finished college, I started in internal communication in different consultancy firms. And well, I'm married, I have 2 kids. So, well, I started working as an employee and now I'm in another chapter of my life. My kids, one is turning 12 this Friday, the one is 6 years old.
Tell us a little bit about all those people you work with.
Well, for internal communications, it's a nice group. We are at 17. We are 3 partners, with 3 business partners, and then we have designers, we have copywriters, we have video editors and consultants. And we also add some people for special projects that have special skills for something in particular. Really what we do is helping companies communicate better with their employees and also help the employees communicate better with each other through processes of change. I mean, now all companies are in a process of change.
So as you started working in the business world as an employee way back then before the family and such, and then you made this transition, have you ever hit a stumbling block in work or life that really affected your work?
Yeah, I mean, about 5 years ago, I was going through a coaching process, which was really profound in me. It was really great. And well, I made the decision to leave a job where I had been for like 10 years. And there were like several factors that led me to this decision. On the one hand, I personally had change in me. I mean, besides the coaching and the yoga, that also helped a lot, and some key people in my life, I no longer felt myself in that company where I was. So at that moment, at this key moment, I had a 5-year-old and the baby. So it was like a convulsion time. So a series of events started to take place, and that was like sort of magical. I mean, in my world, it was like the dot, like Steve Jobs says, the dots will connect eventually. And they started to connect. really chaotic at the first time. But well, what happened is that a colleague of mine recommends me to another company to be hired. So for a very important corporate position. So I go through the whole process, the interviews and everything, and I get selected. And at the last moment, I say, no, this is not something for me. This is not going to help me grow. This is not where I want to go. So I didn't know where to go either. But
tell me why you felt that way.
I want to grow as a person. I mean, it's not that it's all right for other people, but in that moment for me, I didn't want a corporate position because it was not going to look what I wanted to define myself. Because all my life, I was accepting proposals from other employers and trying to accommodate to those proposals. And at this moment, I wanted to ask myself, well, what do you want to do? Create what you want to do. So even talking to my coach, I said, well, this is not the way. I'm still going forward with the interviews and everything. And it was a Friday and I was going to start on Monday. And I said, I'm so sorry, but I'm not going to go. And it was like terrible because I had left my other job and I didn't have this future job. So I got nothing. And I got like really a huge fear of not being able to reinsert myself in a job, especially in a country like Argentina. So working to me, it's something that defines me. No, it's not just a job and then it's my life. My job is something very important in my life. So this situation of not wanting to go to a company, but at the same time not knowing what to do, was very much a way of my balance place, you know? And the main feeling is fear. It's not a fear of not having money or something to eat or live in your daily life, but it's a fear of not finding myself, of this, maybe this stupid thing of saying you're at a certain age where you should be have these all these things resolved, and it was like a change of direction that I had in my mind that made me rethink many fundamental things of my identity. So, and there was not a D-Day where I said, well, yesterday I was bad and now I'm great. It was like a gradual process where I realized what I wanted to do and how could I shape it somehow, day by day.
What were some of the key discoveries that you made in that soul searching time?
Well, mainly it was creating something that is mine and that has all the ingredients that I consider valuable and that are part of my values or my work culture. And I mean, it has to do with what I said before that, I mean, I was always accepting other proposals. And now I'm on my own and thinking, well, what shape do you want to give to this? So mm-hmm. It was very frightening, but I moved forward. So here I am.
It's interesting. One of the things that happens in a corporate life, which is what I've spent most of my time in, is that you feel like you are doing something for someone else, but if you're on your own, you get to decide. But you have clients. The problems are the problems. What do you think the difference is? If it mentally, intellectually, they feel like they should be very similar, but I understand the feeling that you're having. It can arise in a lot of people that work for companies. What is that that's going on? And is there a way to rethink it? If there's an employee or a contractor that's committed to a company, could they gain that fresh perspective inside?
I think it's very personal. I mean, you can be in a corporate position or in any company and feel you're doing what defines you or what you want to do. And sometimes you don't. It has to do with your DNA, I guess, or the evolving of your DNA, maybe, because at some point of your life, maybe it's you feel great and you feel at your essence when you are in a corporate position. And then if you're somewhere else, if you are independent, you don't, and vice versa. So I think it's a personal path, if I understood your question.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. So tell me this. Let's fast forward just a teeny bit and let's go to some of your clients. Now, you have some great names that even U.S. people recognize. One is PepsiCo and some others.
McCain, Novo Nordisk, Apple Leisure Group, which is in the U.S., and ProMujer, which is international organization for helping women, which I'm very proud of being the agency, and many other clients that there are banks or insurance companies that Generali, for example, it's an insurance company that is in many countries also, and then we have many clients that are in the South Cone, in Argentina, Chile, and Uruguay.
That's great. I'm wondering, you know, the big ones that you've got, they didn't just show up right at the beginning with no effort.
And they have a budget to invest in someone to advise on how to get the best in communication with their employees.
Hmm. Interesting. One of the problems that you solve that I think is really fascinating is you had some of the strategy elements. I do strategy projects with clients as well, but you provide a very interesting piece that is a big problem, which is the communication of those elements. It's always mysterious to them why they can't send the executives offsite to some wonderful resort, decide on things by themselves, write a beautiful one-page document and email it out and mention it in a meeting and then have people say, well, I don't even understand the strategy or not follow it or not be engaged with it or feel strongly about it. And it's a mystery to them because people should just listen and obey. That's not quite how it works, is it?
It doesn't work like that, not at all. I mean, if we have the values hanging in the wall, it's not going to do anything. I mean, we have a simple strategy that has a couple steps, which is, well, first you have to make people part of that strategy, part of those values, of those principles, of those rules. I mean, if they don't have a part of that, it's difficult that they adopt it. But our strategy, it's about first empowering leaders, and have them say, well, yes, I want to be part of this and I'm gonna put myself into service for all these projects, whatever it is. If it is training initiative, if it is a new mission, vision, values, if it is agile methodologies or employer branding, or whatever it is, you need endorsement from the leaders. And then if we have that, then we do the awareness phase. I mean, everyone has to know that this is going on, that this is important to the company. I mean, this is what I'm saying now is mostly how we measure if internal communication projects work or don't work. I mean, if we have leaders endorsing this, if we have leaders, people saying, well, I heard about this. This is the awareness phase. And we got everyone to understand that this is important and that is that is having a place in the agenda of the organization. And then we have the understanding phase, which is, well, I know that this is going on in the awareness space, but now I need to know how this impacts myself, how this change is going to impact the way I work, the way I relate to my boss, I relate to my team, the way this industry is going to develop, and how am I going to do things different now that this is in the company? For example, let's say if there's a new system to digitalize everything we do. So, and then we move to the adoption phase, which is, well, what am I going to do as an employee to nurture this, to put something of myself, let's say suggestions. This is a more interactive phase where we do contest challenges, co-creating stuff about these subjects, and then we measure what we did. And in the middle, we are measuring all the time. Do people know about this? Yes, okay. Let's move to understanding. Do people understand what they have to do in this? What part do they take? How important is their position there? And then how many people are involved in this? How many people participated in the contest, in the challenge, in whatever we do? And that is how we measure if this is a successful project. And I mean, if we don't, we can't measure that, it's pointless.
It's going to be like it usually is without an investment in someone like you. So somewhere along the way, the leaders haven't all gotten on the same page and said, we are together and we're going to take a new course slightly, at least, with these elements that are fairly traditional in strategy. And then if the people that actually are doing the work don't really understand it or even know about it, that's a problem in awareness. And if no one's doing it, obviously it's been just a big gigantic waste of time. I love some of the examples that you have, and whatever you're comfortable sharing, I would love you to share those examples to the audience, any of them.
For example, what you mentioned, if you take the leaders somewhere to create, you know, a new process or whatever, and then they don't cascade it to the team, their teams, it doesn't work. So what do? We first encourage them to do so, and we give them tools to be able to do it. Because sometimes they say, well, I don't know how to do this, which is perfectly normal. So we have to, internal communication departments have to teach them how to do that and help them do it. And then we give them stuff, something material to have in their hands. So this is a really pushy part, because you have a kit to deploy this with your team, and this is burning, you know? You have to use it, and you have to sit them and make this meeting and start a conversation with your team about it. And then you have to upload the picture of that meeting, and you have to show it to everybody. And this is contagious, you know? And you see, well, this person is doing it, this other colleague of mine is doing it, well, I have to do it, because I have this week to deploy this with my people. And I cannot be left behind. So we put different strategies to make them do it. And when they do it, they say, well, it was great doing it. I wasn't going to do it because I was not used to do that. But once I did it, I said, well, that's great. I'm going to do this a lot more often. Just sit with your people, listen to them, see what they think about it, what they understand what you're saying, and see different mindsets. Because when you say something, the other person might understand something completely different. We are not empty, a clean canvas. So we complete whatever it is everybody is saying to us with what we have in our minds. So it's a great exercise to do that. To say, well, what did you get of what we talked about? What is important, key, what we discussed?
I think one of the clear examples that you have is sometimes financial leaders feel like everyone should understand the financials. Sometimes they hide them, which is even worse. But, you know, the next option is to present them in a way that people start to doze off in a minute. And if they're part of a 3.5 hour meeting, there's a lot of people that are mentally fading. So yeah. I love your example of that. Could you share a little bit about that example?
Well, this is something that happens in many companies, that normally CFOs speak in certain language that regular people don't understand. They talk about EBITDA or terms that we don't know what they are. I mean, I'm not a number person, but, and I started learning that, but the rest of the people in the organization don't usually, they're not that familiar to that. And sometimes in internal meetings, town halls, and presentations, some people in the financial world speak in that matter. So that means we don't get to understand what we need to understand, which is, are we doing good or are we doing bad in this area, in this company, in this region? So in one example of PepsiCo, for example, we transformed in the town hall meeting the CFO into the weatherman, which we made like a sketch. We presented an idea of a town hall meeting, which was like Saturday Night Live. So like the show in the US. And one of the sketches was, let's present the CFO as the weatherman. So we could understand very, very easily how the numbers are doing, and also doing it in a way that is a lot of fun. So when you present the numbers, and we also made a speech like very simple, and there's a sun shining there, well, we're doing great. And then if there's a storm, then we're not doing so well. And then he would explain why. But this was a great way for people to understand. And we did that in many other forms, in other companies, to let people get in the business, to get their minds in, well, we need to work harder, or we should celebrate, to really get inside what is going on.
So on that particular example, it seems like the key element was there are various ways that individuals and maybe even the information or roles are creating a communication that's not as effective as it could be. And you are asking, what would the most effective way for that information and that person interact with the other people that they're trying to communicate with? And so kind of flip the natural way that it has been happening on its head and put it in a skit that is the antithesis, the exact opposite of that broken way that they're communicating. That's a fun way to kind of make them transition and change and morph into a better way. Is that kind of what you were doing in that case?
Well, something we always say change in change agency is we need the punch in the eye, you know? What we mean by that is the punch in the eye is, let's call your attention. Because attention is what we are competing with right now, because we can't hold the attention of the people. So in order to get them aware of something or understanding something or adopting something, we need to catch their attention. And this way, or using extreme creativity, or doing something disruptive in a campaign catches your attention, and then maybe you like what you see and you get involved and you get amused with what the company is doing and you really feel identified with it. So this is how we start communicating. This is something we try to do all the time. That's why we have many people in the team from the advertisement world, not only from the communication world.
What other types of categories of communication within a company aren't doing so great?
Before, the employer branding was something that was done by as an external communication. And now the walls between the external and the internal are very thin and very transparent. So because people are looking for authentic communication, and the most authentic thing is people from within the company saying, what is it like to work here? So if you are thinking about, well, which company do I want to be? Do I want to apply to? Well, I'm going to go to this company, which I like what the people in there are doing, are saying, and not an advertisement which says, we're great, we're the best employers or whatever. So I'm going to listen to the people inside. They're not going to say any lies, you know? They are going to be authentic. So we are working with them to say, well, you're proud of this company. Say it out loud. We encourage you to say it out loud. And maybe this is something that is not happening and we're helping people. Well, and sometimes they say, well, I never thought about that. Never thought about saying that out loud on LinkedIn, for example. And now I'm starting to do it. Anything, you have to tell people, how does it work? Why is it so good for them? What are the benefits so that they can get aware, understand it, and adopt it?
What are the challenging moments that you face?
Well, sometimes when we start projects that are like huge, many people say in the listening part of the project, well, we are not going to be able to do this. That happens a lot. Now, we are such a huge company. We are not going to be able to deploy all this, to transform like that. This is for small companies, for more agile companies. We're huge. There's too many people that it's not going to have the mindset. And what we do there is try to be empathetic to those people and to show them data, you know, to show them this is something we did, for example, for a company that was having a new method of doing things in the agile movement. And they said we're not going to be able to transform in that way. So what we did was we took a character, we put a disguise in one of the board directors. We made him dress as V from Vendetta. And this is someone who says like, everything's wrong, this is not gonna work. And so we, in the middle of a presentation, we cut the transmission and it was like a virus, like in your computer, like something appeared and it was this person dressed and it was this director with this speech that we made for him. And he was saying, do you think this is going to work? This is not going to work because of this, because of that. And we are not going to be able to do it. And it was like very shocking. And then when the transmission finished, someone from the board of directors said, do you think this is not going to work? I'm going to prove you wrong. And this is the numbers of all the things we are doing right now. The projects, the people involved, the teams involved, the results that we're getting. And so you stop your mind, which is in a way, this is not going to work. They're going to sell me this, but this is not going to work. You stop it because someone was empathetic and told you, well, someone is hearing me. Someone is in my mind and knowing what I think and is proving me with facts and with people involved that this is working. Of course, this is starting in a small part, but this is growing. They're showing me this. So this is the way we started to get more people involved. And how did we realize that some people were thinking this? In a project with many countries, we sent a challenge to do and not too many people were responding. So we said, well, something's wrong. Not so many people are hearing this, are not embracing this. So let's hear people so we can know what you're thinking about it. So we started hearing people, we knew what they were thinking, and we did this initiative. So then things started to change. But sometimes you have to make a stop in your project because sometimes it doesn't go the way you want it to go. Sometimes you have to stop, recalculate, and redo what you had planned and improvise sometimes and make it happen.
Well, when you have a communication with a client that the first time it just doesn't quite take as much as you, it doesn't get as much attention or acknowledgement as you hoped,
what we did in this case, for example, we realized that it doesn't work because we measured. Sometimes, many times, people do campaigns, do initiatives of communication, and they never realize if it worked or not. And this, if you start measuring, you understand that, well, this is not working. So we stop and listen to people. We do a focus group, we do a survey, we do whatever to understand what is it that we're dealing with. What are people thinking about this? I mean, like in life, you have a plan and then you change it along the way. So sometimes we do that too.
If you haven't done surveys or you haven't done a pulse quiz or something like that, you at least have to ask for some of the evidence and learn why it really is and it's not just a perception.
Yeah, totally. And it did in my personal life. I mean, in my search for what I wanted to do, I started listening to people. And when I had no job, I said, what am I going to do? And one dear colleague of mine gave me a great advice. And she said, well, you have to meet people. Well, mostly what you do. You have to meet people and talk about them, about what you do and what they do and what they see of you. And she set me up with someone in the in human resources in Turner just to talk. And she set me up with someone else, and this person set me up with someone else. And in that journey, I learned a lot of what I wanted to do. I started shaping my company. I discovered things about myself that I wasn't seeing. And also I met my business partner. I met Juan, which is my one of my business partners, and in these interviews. So it was funny because I was saying, when I told him, I at that moment I already had some pretty robust idea of what I wanted, and he said, well, all of that you said you do, I have no idea how to do that, but I know how to do everything else that you say you don't know how to do. So we said, well, let's do something together. So then we started change, and then we added another business partner, which is named Carolina, as I am. And that's the three of us. So
what were your strengths that he didn't have?
Mostly in the creative department, thinking very drastic. And he comes from, he was a former director of Walter Thompson, J. Walter Thompson, the ad agency. And so he knows, he's great at what he does. He does great key visuals and great ideas, disruptive ideas, in a mind that is not internal communication. I had a mind really set up in internal communication. So when we got that together, my mind internal communication and his in something disruptive for communication, that we could create something different, which is what I wanted to do. Make a better level of creativity for internal communication, because I knew that things in the conventional way of doing internal communication weren't working because you didn't have that punch in the eye. You didn't have that attention. now more than ever, you need to call people's attention. You don't have people's attention. Embrace that creativity and to do it for a purpose, not only for being disruptive. It's not that we want to be disruptive. We want to do it for a reason. We want to do it because we need to be effective to get a goal, to get a...
You're trying to get a new idea into people's minds, not just have a bunch of fun and distract people from work. You're trying to direct them to the new idea. What are some of the most important things, the real, well, this is what we do steps that you would recommend?
Well, the first thing is to listen and also share the vision that you have. I mean, if you're the owner of a company and you want to make it greater, you have to share and the image of this company in the future and the role of the people now in this future picture. You have to share it with people because normally you don't share it. Normally you keep it to yourself and then you argue about how do they think about this and do I think about that? I mean, you have to share that and then listen to them. When you listen to people and when you understand what they are thinking and you get to answer to them, you create more confidence in the group. And if you create confidence in your work group, that's the best thing to get more effective. I mean, to get more productive and to be happier at work. I mean, we're all the time at work. All the time that we are awake, we are at work, we have to be in a happy place.
Should be. If we can get that vision, it gets us a name to point at and pursuit becomes exciting rather than drudgery and just a paycheck. I think it's excellent. So on the second step, when you're measuring awareness, how do you measure if people are aware of those ideas?
I usually would walk around the companies and talk to people. Then with the pandemic, it was more complicated. I mean, I was in my car going to a company, to another, like 3-4 hours a day. Mm-hmm. Now, we usually use surveys and we use focus groups, but we use a lot some internal communication platforms. There are many. You have Interact, which is very well known in the US. You have Slack, you have Workplace, you have InTouch. There are many. It works like a social media, but for work. And in this way, we can measure a lot, not only because we can have pulse surveys there, but also because, for example, we were talking about the importance of compliance in a company. And we started and values and being honest and being right about the way you behave in the company. So we started that with a picture of someone. You're going to think it's very weird this, but in Argentina it makes a lot of sense. Someone that dropped the wallet and someone found it. What would you do? It was the question. So people started saying, well, that happened to me and no one said gave me anything. Someone gave it, but without the money. And someone gave it, but I would give it without touching it. I would do that. I would do this. So that started a whole conversation. So that's a way for us to measure, well, this is something people are interested in. Or maybe in the way that we put it, they are interested in. And then that was a warm up for starting to talk about the manual for conduct and well-being in the well conduct in the company and the compliance and everything. So that was the start of the campaign.
So very, very simple, practical example to kind of start things off and see if there's an engagement. If there's no engagement, no one cares, then maybe it's not the right value to pick.
Yeah, but this worked a lot.
As you get to people to do some of these things, what are some of the most effective ways you've been able to aid?
Yeah, to adopt what the change is. what we did was people were invited to say, what do we need to incorporate in our code of conduct? What do you think it's important that we all do, that we all take care? Sometimes we do like a trick and we send you like an email that is a trick, but it's made by the company, to see if you get hooked there or not. And then you have the learnings of that. And then maybe your adoption thing is a task for you to let other person know what you don't have to do. And maybe it's the same employee in a selfie mode, recording himself saying, or herself saying, well, I have a tip for you not to fall in these traps. And it is that when you receive something like this, you don't have to do this or you don't have to do that. And you have to ask, I don't know, whatever. And I am going to nominate someone else in the company, and he or she nominates someone to deliver another tip. So that starts a chain of people, the same employees. It's not the company communicating to the employees. It's the employees communicating between themselves and getting them wiser about this subject. And we can apply that to many other projects.
That's terrific. So you referred to some of those things earlier, I think, as challenges, that you find challenges to send out and see if people will do these creative things, and you get to see if there is adoption and application and doing. Is that how you talk about it?
Yeah, totally. Those are challenges, like the ice bucket challenge or stuff like that. So people mm-hmm. get involved and actually do things.
You know, it's really great when a leader is an entrepreneur or a very professional CEO, and they get excited about the purpose and they have time to think about it, and they're bright people and they think about it quite often. But they don't transmit that to the rest of the team. And sometimes that team can be hundreds of thousands of people. Sometimes even if it's just 300 people, it's difficult. Tell me a little bit generally about how you might disseminate what you really do as a company if you're talking to clients, and how you make that cascade.
Well, if you have a leader with a clear strategy and a clear vision in his or her mind, where is it? In his or her mind. You have to really get it out of there. And when you put something out, it's not that there's a white canvas in other people's minds. There's always a lot of stuff there. So you start filling it with whatever you can connect with what the other person is saying. So it's really important to work on the narrative of what you want to accomplish. And also, it's the same as with us people, with what we do. What do we care about? You can know what I care about when you say, well, where do you put your money? Where do you put your resources? Where do you put your time? I mean, if I put a lot of time on any project, I put money and I put all the best people that I want, and I keep on talking about that, the message is, this is something I really care about. So you have to dedicate time, resources, money to whatever is it that is important for you. And you have to put it out. And well, we have a strategy for transmitting, for communicating with people, important projects, important visions, mission, purpose in a company, in a family. I mean, we usually work with big companies with many, many employees, but it applies to a couple also. I mean, you have to first call the attention of those people. We like punch them in the eye with a great idea so that it could call their attention. And because this is what we're competing now with people for attention. it's really hard to get people's attention. So we need to get this attention to say, well, this is something that you could care about. This is something that's coming up to the company that is a breakthrough idea that we want to accomplish, that we want to do. And when you do that, you have to start hearing also, well, what did you get of what we said now? What, even in a conversation, what did you understand of what we were talking about? And you would be surprised with the answers. Because sometimes people understand something different. It's not wrong or it's not good or wrong. I mean, it has to do with what they already have in their minds about that subject. So the first step of us, of what we do, of how we help companies develop a strategy is, well, first, we need people to endorse. We need people to say, okay, let's go with this idea. Let's go for it, and we are going to support you. Then this punch in the eye, the awareness moment, where we get people's attention. And once you get people's attention, then you need people to understand what we are talking about. And that demands time. I mean, if this is a breakthrough idea, if this is something that is going to change the company, then you need to talk about it and put it in the agenda for a lot of time. That's the way, that's the way in which you're going to say, well, this is something important for the company because they are talking about it. They are hearing us about it. They are making an event. They are, I am talking with my boss about it. And then they are trying to make sure that I understand what is in there for me.
Mm.
Yeah. Because this is the third step, that you understand how is this going to change our reality? How can we pass from the vision to the action? And then the last time, the last step has to do with adoption. We need people to adopt this new reality. How do we do that? We make them, we get them involved in activities in the way that they could nurture what we are talking about, this vision, that they can participate in something, put something from themselves, and so that they stop hearing and understanding and start acting on it. And if we, at the end of the road, if we can say, well, we had people backing us up for that. We have people saying, well, we heard about this. We heard a lot about this thing. And we understood what was there for us, how this is going to change the company, how this is going to change the market, how this is going to change the relationship in my team, and many more things. And then, well, I got involved because I put something of myself there. I made this bigger with something. Well, if we could do that, then we can say we had a good strategy that worked.
Let's talk about the biggest one. Like 5 years out, we go away as a leadership team. We create a vision of how we're going to upgrade or change for the better how we serve customers. When you are talking about things that big, what are some of the ways that you would get the lower level and the broad set of employees to understand that vision that the leadership has seen in their own mind?
You have to get the emotion in the mix, because how do people buy things, buy ideas, buy anything? You take decisions with the part of the brain that manages the emotions. So you have to get the emotion there so people can have a match with what they feel with this purpose. So what we always get in the plan is someone that you care about, talk to you about that. Have a conversation, not only talk, because when you say talk, it's unidirectional. This has to be a two-way communication. So we always put some dynamics, some games, something to play and to talk about while you play with your team. So you can understand at the same time, what is it that your boss or the people in your team think about this? And you hear what everyone has to say, and you can build a new image together. Let's say, for example, you have a new mission and vision and new values for the company. So you can say, well, one of the values is to be punctual, to be on time, for example. Well, to be on time is not the same for everybody. To be on time could be, I am going to go across the door of the building at 8 a.m. And some for other people could be, well, at 8, I'm already in my computer working with my coffee done. And for other people it doesn't matter the time. I am delivering to my client, to my inner client inside the company, outside the company, whatever, on time. It doesn't matter where I sit, what time I cross the entrance of the company. I mean, there are different ways of understanding. So this conversation is really valuable. So we can all get together at the same vision with practical and simple examples that we all understand how important it is. And it's not the same what maybe I had in mind this, but well, this nurtured what I had in my mind and made it bigger.
And fire the reward centers and enjoy what we're doing to understand until you know enough to say, wow, that's really attractive to me as an individual employee. I think I'm going to be part of this team emotionally now. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. And so exactly what you said about flexibility also, because everything that you do with human beings has to be flexible. Where all the plans that we have, the strategies, they are never done, finished the same way they were planned. We have measurement moments all the time, and we are all the time trying to see, well, this is working, no, this is not working. Well, we're going to do this other thing to make this part work. And well, this is going really well. Maybe this could be enhanced with something else. And we're all the time seeing this because we have an idea of how the project is going to be developed, but sometimes we have surprises, good surprises, bad surprises. I mean, it's the way it is. And it's really great. And it's always a nice surprise to see how people are evolving with the project and making this project. Once you got it, once you understood it, the part when you want to be part of it, it's really nice to see that part. And of course, in a transformational project, in when we're talking about culture, when we are talking about communication or digital transformation, there are some people that don't want to follow, or they are the lazy adopters, on the contrary of the early adopters. And well, we have to know that this is part of the equation also. We have to help them a little more to get, we don't have to think this is not working because some groups are not accompanying the project the way we are thinking it.
You have to find ways to tease it out of those laggards.
People can nominate themselves, can say, well, I'm really fond of this. I want to participate. And these people, we are going to cherish them, and we are going to give them the prime news of what we're doing so they can help us be enthusiastic with other teams. They can help us communicate in bigger teams, because when you are talking about 10,000 people in a company, you really need many, many people to help you. There is no team in HR or communications that is big enough. We always need people that besides what they do every day, maybe they're a lawyer or they're in finance or they're in administration or whatever they are, they also have a part of themselves that say, well, I really like communication. I really like culture. I really like technology. I want to help. And sometimes even they help other teammates to adopt a new technology, or they help them participate in something because they don't know how, or they are afraid or whatever, and then they get enthusiastic together.
What are you doing in Agile that you're communicating?
Going Agile in a company is transforming your mindset, is transforming your culture. So what we do is we help the company to communicate better. So you can get this transition from a non-agile mindset to an agile mindset.
So the transition you usually focus on is transitioning.
Communicate that. And sometimes, I mean, the agility world is very big, and you can pick things from that to enhance your company's performance. And let's say, for example, one company that we work with, they said, well, we want shorter meetings, 25-minute meetings only. We want only 5 slides PowerPoint presentations only, no more than 5 slides. We want, I mean, many things about, they had like 10-point agile changes that they wanted to accomplish in a first stage. But they were like really simple, but simple to say and difficult to implement. And if you are doing something, you don't have to wait until it is completely done so you can deliver. You have to show it to see the minimal valuable product. So, and then you go making enhancements to that, focused on exactly what you want to get. And then you make enhancements. And it makes you rethink things in a completely different way.
And so you're in the business of trying to change those minds and get them to grasp the new paradigm.
Communication for that. There's no way. I mean, you have to say, well.
You can't just say it once and have it magically happen.
When you start the next day, you start doing the things exactly the same as you used to do. Unless you keep on talking about that in the understanding phase, where you say, well, you used to do this PowerPoint of 85 slides, not anymore, cut it off. I mean, you have to have 5 slides. If you can't explain it in 5 slides, you cannot explain it. So if you cannot achieve what you need in a 25-minute meeting, you cannot achieve it. So when you start doing that and you start showing it with examples from leaders, from the champions, from the agility champions, you start seeing the results. The same people are going to be able to achieve more and to deliver more, to add more value to the customer.
What made you get into this business? It's a very unusual sort of business.
I started this without really, at that moment, knowing why I was getting in there. And now, with the years gone by, now I started realizing why I got here. All the people in my family that you can say this could totally be fixed with communication, with better communication. And now looking backwards, I understand that maybe this is why I got in communication.
Yeah. Well, you're not alone. I mean, every family deals with it, even the greatest families, but it's a process. You know, the most beautiful thing is to work a lifetime and connecting with all of the members of a family. And you may barely pull it off, or maybe not in this life, but I think it's all about that. And so it's a beautiful thing. It's a great challenge. There's nothing in life worth doing unless it is a great challenge. Can you think of one or two really exceptional outcomes?
Yeah, I see that all the time. When they do cultural transformation or agile transformation, I mean, you can see people get happier first.
Yeah.
And they get people getting achieving things faster and with more quality in less time. Then you have more time to think strategy. Maybe those innovation results are in 3-4 years the best selling thing in the company. Communication changes things.
Well, I want to thank you for letting me have you on this.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Carolina Doldán, partner at Change Agency in Buenos Aires, voted one of the top female leaders in all of South America. I love in our episode how you ask and answer. If you have a leader with a clear strategy and a clear vision in his or her mind, where is it? It's in his or her mind. You have to really get it out and get it into the minds of everyone else, or you're not leading. Work on the narrative, what you want to accomplish, because communication will change things. Thank you for joining us to get leaders unstuck and thriving with their teams. You've heard a little bit about the power of bold encounters and leadership. Watch on, go to full episodes with the iconic expert interviews at markspencercook.com/podcast. And please subscribe. My site takes you directly to YouTube video and podcast versions. Please make comments, share this with your friends. Also, reach out to us to just brainstorm your priorities, challenges, events, or how bold encounters might help. Visit windfallpartners.com, click the Let's Talk button without obligation, and reach out. I look forward to speaking. Thank you for joining us. Now, let's lead with bold encounters today.